Man, it has been an incredible couple weeks. Let me fill you in. But first, man, it's an honor to pastor. It is. I have fallen absolutely deeper in love with pastoring the last few years, more than I ever could have imagined. At first, kind of felt like I got stuck. Kind of drew the short straw when my mom passed away. My dad was like, I don't want to do it anymore. And then just all these other things and chaos in life and building the building and going through my mom passing and just the growth and stuff. And the last few years, it has just been absolutely amazing and an honor. So thanks. It is so fun to come in here every day and not know what to expect. Like, just like Nicole said, just to have that hunger to know that the Lord is going to do something. We are open to whatever that is. We're not scripted. We're not on a schedule or an agenda. Sorry if you guys have lunch plans at certain weeks. But we just love the Lord, and we want to pursue him and just see what he does week to week with who's in the room. But man, it is an honor. And it was so cool to hear Josh speak last week and honor my dad. So this is Father's Day for me. My family's celebrating me today because we were out of country and didn't get to do that fully last week. But Dad, could you just stand? I know they honored you last week, and he's the founder of Upper Room. He's my dad. Actually, Dad, I'm going to give this to you. There you go. Love you, Dad. What Josh said last week about my dad was so true that he embraces, he at least tolerates the change. And the last 12 to 13 years that I've been pastoring, what a champion he has been and an encourager. He came into my office before I left a couple weeks ago and just said that I was one of his heroes. Well, he's one of my heroes, so he is one of the heroes in my life. So anyway, love him. Love you guys. Thank you. Man, we just want to welcome the Harmons. I've lost track maybe where they're sitting. Harmon, thank you guys. I know Andrew and Lily were helping lead worship last week. They're here from Kansas City. We love you guys. They were part of our home. They're still part of our family, but they were home here for over 7 years serving with us. And it's always an honor to have you back for Poultry Days. I mean, in Upper Room here just to visit us. But anyway, so good. And I heard there was a bloodbath. Now, Josh did not clarify. I listened to the podcast, and he's like, there's a bloodbath next week. And I'm like, softball. Josh, say softball. But our two Upper Room softball teams played each other Friday night. I heard it went to the last inning, and I heard it was 13 to 12. So, but guess what? The good news is Upper Room won. Hey! Hey, we want to welcome a new little member to the church. Kaylee, Cody, and Margo brought little Poppy with them back today. So welcome them from a distance, and we love little babies. But man, so good to have you guys here. I don't know if you were here last week, maybe, but I'm here now. So welcome for the first time for me. All right, it's glad to be back. We arrived around 4:30 this morning. There was delay after delay, just issues getting in, and we found ourselves eating supper at Charlotte Airport around 11 o'clock last night, and I said, no matter what, I was looking into rental cars. I was like, we are making it. I am preaching tomorrow. It's just going to happen. So, but we, those of you who don't know, we were in St. Lucia the last 15 days. So, boo-hoo, boo-hoo. We did a week of missions, and so glad to have the Haas family. Reese joined us, which she's 18 today. Happy birthday, Reese. Super fun, and here in a little bit, I'll go through a list of what we did. Then my family stayed an extra week and vacationed, and I was thinking, any Office fans in here? The Office, any? Oh, man, welcome home. I was thinking about coming back like Andy Bernard did after a sailing experience in the Caribbean. Not yet. Not yet. All right, we'll get there. Give me a minute. But anyway, I thought about coming back like Andy Bernard, but then I started to grow the beard out, and it just came in fully gray. I was like, I can't do it. I had to shave it. But we did bring back the St. Lucian weather. It's rainy season, rains at night, 86 during the day. So you're welcome. Brought back some rain and good weather. All right, on with this. How many enjoyed Jeff Butson a couple weeks ago and the word he brought and the story? Thank you for sharing. It was awesome. I love the disentangled story and your story in Isaiah 55, Matthew 6. Touch on a little bit of that today. And then last week, obviously, Josh with Barnabas. And man, what a great story, right? Great points on fatherhood. So I'm going to continue. Today's my Father's Day message. So you get Father's Day times two. I'm not going to be biased like Josh was and only speak to the fathers. I'm going to speak to all today, all right? So it's just how it's going to be. But we are going to title this message, One Love. Okay, and it's got some influence here over the last couple weeks. Could you cue that again? That was when it was supposed to go. Title it, One Love. We're going to title this message, One Love. There we go. All right. We'll get there at the end anyway. But there's actually a lyric in the song. I was like, man, it'd be so fun to bring some of this back. And I was listening to it on the plane. I had tried to download the sermons. I got Jeff's downloaded. I got on the plane. Josh's wasn't, so I had to listen to that a little later. But then I started listening to some Bob Marley and to pass some time, because my goal, my only goal on airplanes, is to teleport. That's it. Whether I fall asleep or watch a movie, whatever it is, I've been praying for teleportation. It hasn't happened. But anyway, I did watch an incredible movie last night called The Blind or something. It's the story of Phil Robertson. And I would recommend that movie. It is incredible, mimics a lot of my story and what Nicole and I went through, and had no idea about some of that with him and what he journeyed through before Jesus. All right, let me recap the trip, the missions trip. You are part of a church that has a heart for missions locally, nationally, internationally. We have a church in Mexico. We have ministry in St. Lucia. We have tons of stuff going on in Dominican Republic, Bahamas, all over the place, and we're excited. I know there's stuff in Honduras and things to come. We're just constantly, Costa Rica, is that what you said? Okay, Costa Rica, yes. They moved back, but we still have churches there that they are serving, and we are along with them. Anyway, so we love to pour out upon all. Like, it's the local, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. So that's our heart. Our heart is to reveal Jesus to anybody that we can, whether that's tomorrow at the grocery store, or I work full-time at the fire department, shining my light at the fire department, discipling guys at the fire department in Troy, or whether that's going on missions trips, or that you're part of the prayer team when people go on missions trips, whatever that is. And so what we did, and what you were part of hopefully praying for us, was we did the first night we were there, we did a cookout with leaders. Through the week, we did a marriage and singles workshop for the church there. We went to a daycare, their preschool, it's called Genesis, and we shared the gospel, and I'll get more into this later, but everywhere we go, we do this object lesson with kids mostly, these beads representing, you know, sin, death, Jesus, his blood covering at the cross, hope, all of that. So we do this object lesson, we can do it in any language, we have cards printed in Spanish, and we go, and it's just this effective way to share the gospel and allow kids to choose Jesus. And so we've been a part of this, and so we did that at the daycare and preschool, sang with them, played games, helped with their snacks. We also did that at a special needs school. There's a section of their public school that's for the special needs. And let me just say something, that we did the same thing, object lesson, we sang for them, we kind of did some fun things, activities, and then they sang for us. And when we were leaving, you know, these are rejected people in society, and just these kids that are there, and all the way up to about 20 years old. And they began to sing Jesus Loves Me for us. And to see these kids sing that, there was this young man, every time we'd sing, he'd do this thing. And man, I'll never forget that young man, and he just captured my heart. And I just walked away and began to weep, because these are kids that are the most rejected in society, and they are singing, it's in their heart, Jesus Loves Me. This I know, in a public school. And then we got to share the gospel and sing our Christian songs to them too. And it was just incredible. But we, I think, need to adopt their playground. That section of the school, their playground, is fenced in with a tree, a trampoline that's on the ground in pieces, and a broken slide. That's their entire playground, whereas the other schools have better playgrounds. So I took a lot of pictures and videos. I was like, I think we need to help the local church there adopt that playground. We did it in Tipp City. We can do it in St. Lucia. Went to a fire department and brought them a snack basket, shared the gospel, prayed for them. We saw a lady walking on the street. We're in a kind of a caravan there. We had two large cars or vans. And we saw a lady on the street walking towards us that said, Ohio. We're like, let's stop. We should probably pray for her. So we stopped and got to pray for her. She needed physical healing and prayed for her. We went to Sunday service, kids' church. We cleaned the church and cleaned up this room. And we thought we were just doing something just to humble ourselves and go low. And then Pastor Kendall, Bishop, told us, he's like, actually, I've been looking for somebody to clean out this room so that we can expand our kids' ministry, and I haven't been able to find anybody. So we actually met a huge need, and it was incredible. But there's something powerful about serving in missions. There's something powerful. If you've not done it, I encourage you to do it. And that is on some type of formal trip. Not to go visit somebody, but to actually go into the neighborhoods, to go into the schools, to go into their culture, whatever it is. If you find somebody to go with, or we host several trips a year, go with us. And I know we're going to have one coming up in Mexico that we want to go in and serve. And you can take your family there. I love taking my kids. So today's message is honestly a lot to do with that. My family, all of my siblings go to church here. They're all members here. And there's four of us. We're all married. And we have this sibling text called Grade 8. And Walt sent a really sweet text. My brother-in-law, Cheryl's husband, sent this really sweet text. He's like, so nice that God and career allows you to do this. I feel, because we kept sending pictures and videos and everything we were doing. I like to update my family. We stay pretty close through that. And it says, I feel that serving the desire of your heart is a blessing to all. It's super sweet. And it was just like, man, that is so true. And I was like, yeah, definitely fulfill. This was my reply, my text reply. It definitely fulfills the desires of our hearts, but also the desire of God's heart. Super cool and humbled to introduce people to and expose them to God's love. Certainly with a cost, out of our comfort zones, with bugs, critters, heat, more bats. I was just doing like a night swim in our pool at our villa where our team was staying. And all of a sudden, this fruit bat just kept dipping in and getting a drink of water right where I was. I was like, I can't get rid of these bats. Wherever I go around the world, there's these bats. And if you don't know us, maybe you're new here, I have had this journey, this adventure with bats for the last 6 years. It's been amazing. But so worth it. I said this, but so worth it. Also beyond words to be able to teach our girls serving and missions, worth every hour of vacation I spend from the fire department. I only get it allotted a certain amount of hours I can leave. And sometimes I choose that over going fishing or hunting or golfing a day. I choose to save my vacation to do these things with my kids and to teach this, and it is worth it. So we got into this conversation. There was this long drive. I mean, it is, I think, 11 miles or something from the city we do ministry, where our church is in Soufre, to the North Island. But it is through the jungle, it's through the mountains. We had to stop three, yes, Dramamine did not work. We still had to stop three times for Hadassah on the side of the road. Christine's been with us. She knows this drive, as well as many of you in here, and it's rough. So we got in this big conversation, and I just began to pour out my heart to my girls. And I was like, girls, if there's two things I could get in you, I don't know, it's like a dad moment. And I was like, one is this, that God loves you, that you are loved. And this is what I'm just sharing with my girls. This is like dad talk, all right? So I'm just going to give you the dad talk today. Everybody say dad talk. I love the dad talk once a year. So the two things I said, first off, that God loves you. Know without a shadow of a doubt that God loves you. You are loved. You are his child. God loves you. The second thing is that Jesus died for you. He resurrected for you. He's waiting in heaven, and he gave his spirit to you. Those two things, and like Nicole said, sometimes we complicate this. That is the simple gospel. That is it. You are loved. Jesus came. He paid a price for you. He washed away all your sin. He resurrected, conquered death, hell, and the grave, welcoming you into eternity forever with him if we choose him, right? And we accept this free gift, and his spirit, while we're here, dwells inside us. Those are the two things I said, and I begin to just kind of share my heart, because I don't care what church you end up going to. This is kind of the things I'm saying. I don't care if you go to Upper Room or don't go to Upper Room. I don't care if you end up in missions or go all over the world. It doesn't matter. I don't care if you're in ministry or not. I don't care what socioeconomic class you end up in, what home, what career. If you just know God loves you, that he came for you and he paid a price and he resurrected for you, everything else will work out, and it actually doesn't matter anyway. Some of us, we work our whole life to build this or do this or give our kids this or build up this future for them, which is awesome, or provide an education or whatever, and those are great things, and they propel you to your destiny and purpose and calling in life, and I get that. But without the first two things, none of it matters anyway. Without knowing that you're loved and that Jesus is the one that did it all, then it doesn't matter I would live in a box and have Jesus. I would live in some of the shacks we took pictures of and have Jesus than a mansion anywhere and not have Jesus. So I'm just sharing this with my family, and then the Lord began to pull me into this, and I journaled this one night, and the first night I was like, that's what I'm preaching, because I may not leave them money. I come from a deep heritage, a rich, rich inheritance. I have an incredibly rich inheritance coming my way. His name's Jesus. I don't think I'm going to have much, a whole lot more than that. Maybe the Lord will bless us. But it doesn't matter. I don't need it. I don't want it. We've told my dad, spend it, have fun in life, enjoy it with Patty and everybody else, and spend it on the grandkids, because you've given us Jesus. So I may not leave much, but the one thing I want to leave, and if I leave tomorrow as a church, as a father of this body, you know, I leave you these two things. Know that you are loved. And know that Jesus paid a price. He came on a cross. He resurrected. He conquered death on the grave. He's waiting in heaven, and he poured his spirit out to live inside you. All right. So then I'm reading my Bible, and as I journal this, I just flip. I was like, what verse goes with that? And I started to read. The one that leaped out was 1 John 3:1. It's my favorite verse. But if I was picking a single verse, it might be this. But 1 John 3:1. And then I begin to read the whole chapter. So I'm going to read the entire chapter. In NLT, you can read along on the screen or get your Bibles out or Biblia. I love this. And I remember this being the heart of our youth ministry, especially the explanation point at the very end of the first verse. See how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. Right there, there's your identity. There's your identity wrapped up in everything. It's not your title at work. It's not the role you play on earth. It's not anything else but son, daughter, child. Right there. We know whose we are and who we are. It doesn't matter who rejects us, because we know who accepts us. It doesn't matter what we go through, the trials, because we know without a shadow of a doubt, Jesus loves us. God loves us. Let me read on here. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown what we will be like when Christ appears. But we know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. And all who have this eager expectation will keep themselves pure just as he is pure. Everyone who sins is breaking God's law, for all sin is contrary to the law of God. And you know that Jesus came to take away our sins, and there is no sin in him. Anyone who continues to live in him will not sin, but anyone who keeps on sinning does not know him or understand who he is. Dear children, don't let anyone deceive you about this. When people do what is right, it shows that they are righteous, even as Christ is righteous. But when people keep on sinning, it shows that they belong to the devil, who has been sinning since the beginning. But the Son of God came to destroy the works of the devil. Now, this is the gospel. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. He came to destroy sin and anything attached to it. Those who have been born into God's family do not make a practice of sinning because God's life in them. So they can't keep on sinning because they are children of God. So now we can tell who are children of God and who are children of the devil. Anyone who does not live righteously and does not love other believers does not belong to God. Let me read on here. This is the message you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. Everybody say, love one another. We must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. And why did he kill him? Because Cain has been doing what was evil and his brother had been doing what was righteous. So don't be surprised, dear brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. If we love our Christian brothers and sisters, it proves that we have passed from death to life. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. Oh, man. And you know that murderers don't have eternal life within them. Okay, now here we get to some meat here. You guys ready for it? We know what real love is because who? Jesus gave up his life for us, so we also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters. If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let's show the truth by our actions. Our actions will show that we belong to the truth so that we will be confident when we stand before God. Even if we feel guilty, God is greater than our feelings and he knows everything. Don't always trust our feelings. Our feelings will lead us astray. The Spirit leads us the right way. See, sometimes we may not feel like going on that mission trip. We may not feel like worshiping. We may not feel like singing that same song over and over because it might get boring or it's not in the key we sing it or whatever, right? But they sing the same song over and over and over for eternity and it never gets old. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. And you know they never get bored of it. It never gets old. Dear friends, if we don't feel guilty, we can come to God with bold confidence, and we will receive, that is an invitation, to come boldly before the Lord, to come boldly to his throne. And we will receive from him whatever we ask because we obey him and do the things that please him. And this is his commandment. We must believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Those who obey God's commandments remain in fellowship with him and he with them. And we know he lives in us because the Spirit he gave us lives in us. There's the gospel. It's the gospel. Jesus loves us. God loves us. He created us. He loves us. In his likeness, we were created. In the beginning, he said, let us make man in our image. They threw a party and created you and loves you and absolutely adores you. Not just loves you, he likes you. He wants to spend time with you, right? He's waiting in eternity for you to see him face to face without any reservations or barriers or filters or anything else. Full access. But we get to live that now. And he loves us. He came for us. He died for us. He resurrected for us. His Spirit lives in us so that we will love one another, do things by action and serve, and live righteously. So the caveat to my kids was this. First is, know that you're loved. Second, know that Jesus paid the price and resurrected and gives his Spirit. And then everything else comes from that, and you will love one another. You will serve. It will be in your heart to do missions wherever you are. Now listen, sometimes there's this obstacle, and we think we need to go on this trip to do it. The trip just opens up some access to other cultures, but the reality is the invitation is right in front of you. In your workplace, in your home. Man, the greatest disciples you'll raise are the ones closest to you. So there's this invitation right now, like just to do it where you're at. And that's all of this comes. I want to read one scripture here. Psalms 27:4. Jeff, a couple weeks ago, talked about seeking, the power of seeking. And I heard Steve say that as Nicole mentioned it, to seek his face. And this was in the message to preach, but also later on I'll talk about a different message. But Jeff mentioned Matthew 6 as well as Isaiah 55. And we've been kind of on that. But Psalms 27:4 says this. This has been like our heart for this church, our heart for my family, my personal heart. And it's David's cry, his David's desire, David's goal. This one thing I have asked of the Lord, one thing that I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and that to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. To seek after him, to go after him, to be in awe of his beauty, of his wonder, right? To dwell in his house. Man, how beautiful this is. Look next to you. Look around you. We're with family. These are your brothers and sisters who you're actually commanded to love, even when they offend you, even when they don't shake your hand or do something dumb or say something stupid. Me, I do it all the time. I've offended you, but I'm your brother. And you're my brothers and sisters, and we're here to love one another. And it's beautiful to dwell in this house, in this temple, to seek him and to dwell on his beauty and to fix our eyes on him, because that works everything else out. All right, can I show you, in a moment, I'm going to put a picture up. Well, they're going to put a picture up. On Father's Day morning, no matter where we went in St. Lucia, and kind of where we go anywhere on vacation, it's like children are just drawn to us. It might just be the four girls, and girls are very approachable, and they're always playing. And it was Father's Day, so there was a dad and his wife just way off doing their own thing, and their kids were just playing in the ocean unattended. So they became our kids. Father's Day, I had seven children that day. And so we're playing in the water. All of a sudden, the two boys start fighting and throwing sand. And I was like, hey, knock it off. And dad just came out. I was like, stop that right now. And they're throwing, it's getting everywhere. It's getting all over us. And I was actually just very irritated. I'd taken it for like 27 minutes. And felt like it was probably like two. But anyway, I was like, hey, stop that. And they're like, oh, okay. And they were very repentive. And then I felt really bad. And then I was just like, I don't know what got into me. I was like, thank you. So ever since then, the girls, the whole entire trip after that, were like, hey, Dad, thank you. Now, meanwhile, Kurt, one of our elders and his family are in Japan visiting his family, and he should have been the one saying, thank you. But me, it was like the kids stopped throwing sand. I was like, thank you. So then I get out of the water, and Nicole and I are just hanging out for a few minutes, and we look down, and this is the picture we saw, and this was my Father's Day gift. So there's the little boys, and there's a little girl there, and then all of a sudden we can hear them, and Chloe is showing that little girl her bracelet, and she's going through every bead, and she's going through the entire gospel message and sharing the plan of salvation. And this little girl that day accepted Jesus as her Savior. Now, yes, it's so touching to know that, like, no matter where we go, we share the gospel, and it's just who we are. It's in us, and that's probably why little kids and people are drawn to us. It's not us. I'm not that cool, as much as I want to think I'm still cool. I do have a giant tattoo on my chest, and it says family, okay? It's a massive tattoo. I don't know what I was thinking when I got it. It's actually the only tattoo that Nicole even likes, and it's weird. I mean, it's big. It fills my whole chest, if you didn't know that, full disclosure, okay? I have some weird ones, but so no matter where I go in the world, everybody loves that tattoo. Family man. So I'll come back to a place like, family man, I remember you. So everywhere we go, it's family man. And so anyway, but what the Father's Day gift that was special to me is that we take our girls, I'm saying this message, and it's just in her. We didn't ask Chloe, we didn't nudge them, we're like, hey, you should share the gospel. It's in her just to share the good news with a little girl that we'll never see again, that might end up being a little preacher, might end up being a doctor, might end up being an attorney, might end up working at a resort there, or sandals, sharing the gospel with so many people around the world. We don't know, but there's one little girl's life who has changed forever. That was my Father's Day gift. So a few years ago, Bruce and Catherine Toll had challenged us to create a mission statement. And I just wanted to share our family's mission statement with you. This is in our home. And I know it might be very difficult for some of you to see, so I'll just read it. Obviously, it says Simmons. It's a picture of us. I think I got this for Nicole on Mother's Day or something one time, and I wrote it out and created this. But it says, this is our mission statement, the Simmons Strong. We have a hashtag, Simmons Strong, for our family. It says, to love and to worship God, to love and serve others, to live a life of honor, to have fun and adventure, to value family, and always pursue unity. That's our mission statement. I encourage you to get your own for your family. That's our mission statement. And to see on Father's Day, as I'm sitting there, non-prompted, to see our little girls share the gospel and just play with these other kids, was just the most beautiful thing I think I've seen in a very long time, at least since the week before, seeing these kids sing Jesus Loves Me. But it was just a full trip. So today, my Father's heart for you is this. One, God loves you, that you are loved. Two, that Jesus came, he paid a price for you, he forgives all of your sin, he washed it clean, that he resurrected, he conquered it all, and that he's waiting in eternity to join you forever, and that he left his spirit to dwell inside us, to dwell inside you. And in that, you will find serving, you will find loving others, you will find desiring righteousness, you will find thinking beyond yourself, and thinking of others. You will find that the bigger things in life that we've valued and put up here as idols are actually not really in their rightful place, that God should be there, if we just understand those two major concepts. That's it. That's the gospel. It's the good news. First John depicts it really, really well. So I want to close with this fun little story, okay? I can have six more minutes. I think I'm right on time today, ish. Everybody's like, quit saying that. It's so good. I never look at my watch to see what time it is. Well, sometimes I do, okay? Because I might have brisket on or something else. I don't know. Not today. We're doing steaks today. All right. There's a series. I think it might be on Netflix or something. I tend to find the weird things that my wife won't watch or like. So it's either action, but then that's hard to fall asleep to. So then I get into weird documentaries. Because Nicole, when she hits the pillow, it's 3.2 seconds, and she's out. And I'm like, and she wanted to watch The Office or something, you know, we would like to laugh before we fall asleep. And so I'll have it on, and we're not even through, like, the intro of The Office, and I look over, and she's out. I was like, really? Why do we bother? So then I'll go to some documentary or something, and one of them I watched was Blue Zones. How many in here have seen Blue Zones? All right, let me tell you what this documentary is about. It's worth watching. You will find some spirituality and faith in it for sure, and I'm going to talk about some of that. This is my closing, okay? This is my one-ish closing. It basically studies, I think it was like five or several areas of the most concentrated areas of centurions, people that live 100 or more, okay? So they went to all these areas, Okinawa, Japan, a place in Italy, you know, all over the world. They studied these focused areas of centurions, okay? And they came up with nine reasons these people in these areas live astronomically longer than anybody else in the world, okay? I'd like to just go over those nine things and how this ties in. All right, first off, they move naturally. Most of these areas, they have to move, they have to go get their food, they walk to work, it's mountainous, they're walking through, they're very active. Second, purpose. They have a sense of purpose, and I took this straight from the internet. As far as like pulling out what those main points were. They have a sense of purpose or why I wake up in the morning. This can add up to 7 years of life expectancy. Serving others. All studies, now we got into this conversation with St. Lucia, Pastor Kendall, Josh and I, and we're talking, and Josh had seen a different study in a whole different series or show or documentary, and it he only had like 4 points, and it was purpose. How much purpose is connected to healthy life and longer life. I'll get there in a second. Three was downshift. Find ways to relieve stress, which can contribute to chronic inflammation of disease. This includes practices like prayer, meditation, napping, and participating in social activities. I would probably say Sabbath is in there. 80% rule. Eat until you're 80% full. Plant slant. Emphasize a plant-based diet, beans, all this stuff, especially when natural meats are not available. So we tend to eat meats that are full of crap. All right. Now this one, take or to leave it, take this to the Lord. Wine at 5. Just reading it. Wine at 5. Moderate alcohol consumption, especially wine, with friends and family is common. I almost read communion there, a form of communion. This practice has been associated with lower mortality rates. Okay, 7. Belong. Participate in a faith-based community. This is what it says. Participate in a faith-based community which can contribute to a sense of belonging and support. Loved ones first. Prioritize family. Every time you hear the word family today, you're going to think something way different. Prioritize family and put loved ones first. Keeping aging parents and grandparents nearby, investing in children, and maintaining a committed relationship are typical practices. And then the 9th one, right tribe. Be part of social circles that support healthy behaviors. Social networks have a significant influence on lifestyle choices and overall well-being. All right, so studies show the key to fulfilled life is purpose, the key to a long life is purpose, and I'm just here to tell you that the greatest purpose is through Jesus. Mark 12, 30 through 31 says this. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your mind and all your strength. The second is this, you should love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. It sums it up pretty well. And when you know this, you know your love, because you love God and you love him with everything that you have because you know he loves you, right? Then you love others, you love your neighbor as yourself. All right, could you stand with me? Okay. We're going to have the prayer team come in a moment, all right? I'm going to pray for you corporately. We'll have our prayer team come. If you don't know this, I was roughly 25 years old till I really acknowledged hearing how much God loved me. 25 years of my life went by that I heard he loved me more than he judged me. Okay? So today, this is an overwhelming, overemphasizing message how much God loves you. You are his children. That is what you are. All right? If you don't know that love, if you don't know him as Savior, Messiah, Lord, Healer, Redeemer, all of that, our prayer team is going to be here. We would love to help guide you to the greatest decision and relationship. Isn't that the cue to sneeze? Usually Brittany has like two or three. So, but anyway, man, we want to invite you to that. We also have a gift for you out there. And if you're new here, we have a gift for you. But man, I love you so much. Thank you to me and anybody else who might be celebrating. Happy Father's Day. Happy belated Father's Day to all the dads and guys that were here last week. So I'm going to pray for you, and then we're going to do something fun, okay? All right, Lord, we thank you for this day. And God, your heart, the Father's heart, is just that you love us, that you sent your Son to die for us, to be raised from the dead for us, to separate any veil. The veil was torn and removed from heaven to earth to have full access to you and for your Spirit to dwell in, among, and around us. So we thank you. We receive that. We choose that right now. We choose the gift of salvation. We choose you. We choose to live a life of serving and righteousness because of the love you have for us. And it's just a revelation that changes us and it transforms us and it helps us think and see differently, God. So we thank you. We pray that that just fills us up, that your Spirit will dwell in us and fills us. We pray for an infilling of your Spirit right now. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you are the purpose, that you give us purpose, that you help us see beyond ourselves and to serve others. So God, we thank you. We thank you for your great commission. We thank you for your commands, and we thank you for your invitation for us to love you so well. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.